behind home plate. We bringing it to them all day. All day. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Birdland. Win or lose, we bringing it to you always. Always. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Orange or black, we rebuild the pack. No matter where we at, you know we coming back. Section 336, we on this, so tune in. Tune in. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Yeah. Welcome to Birdland. You know what's up, son. Welcome to Birdland. Birdland.
Now, here come the boys from Section 336.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Baltimore sports fans of all ages, welcome to Section 336, Next Generation Baltimore Sports Talk. I, as always, am your endearing starting host, Matt Soroka. As always, I'm joined by the button lover, Josh Roker.
That button's been there forever, and I don't think we've ever used it. I wasn't prepared to do this episode today. As far as the season's over, we lost. We went into the playoffs and just embarrassed ourselves.
Whoa. Okay.
I mean, we'll get into it, but I mean, today was an ugly loss and a really bad way to end the season.
Yeah.
A sad way to end the season. After a season that's got so many positives, it was a tough way to end it.
Yeah. I mean, I hate even doing this podcast. I don't like to talk after we lose a regular season game, let alone
right.
a playoff game. I mean, we'll see how this goes, but I'm feeling a combination of physically sick, maybe from the White Castle burgers I got at Sam's Club for a game time snack. I might as well do that, but also just the performance I just watched, and then also sad and also annoyed and frustrated that I feel like, you know, on national television in the playoffs, just we didn't play as well as I thought we could play, and it's frustrating.
It's very frustrating. And it is when you and I talked yesterday, and it was like, we had a long day of traveling back and all this, and had to get to the airport at like 5 a.m. thanks to your flight. I said, you know what? It'll be good because we just lost 2 games in a row. We'll win the third one. We'll bounce back and we can have this positive conversation about how we got game 4 and we're going to fight through this. And then to not even fight today. It was tough. Tough to watch. Really hard game just to watch on TV. I can't imagine being there.
Yeah, I mean, when we went on Saturday, I thought we would win the entire time.
Yes.
Until Gunnar Henderson was thrown out in the 9th.
Right. That's where I lost faith.
Oh, and then going into Sunday's game, I was 100% sure, throwing out Grace Rodriguez, I was 100% sure we'd win that game.
Yep.
Until the grand slam in the 3rd.
right. And even then I thought, okay, we're going to fight back.
Yeah. And we did fight back. And then in tonight's game, I thought I was 100% sure we were going to win.
Yeah.
We had that whole sweepless streak. We never lose to the same team 3 times. We have Dean Kramer. There's all the, you know, all the stuff Dean and his family are going through. Maybe there's some inspiration there.
Right.
And you just felt like we can't. This team's too good to lose again. And yeah. Texas is not good enough. And then I thought for sure we'd win this game until that Garcia, whatever, hit that 3-run homer.
Right. Because one run, no problem. It was like, right, the one run, okay, no problem. We knew we were going to have to score runs today. 3 runs, I still felt like, okay, we're getting this. We can get this. But it's our offense came to a complete stop. And I feel like we've seen this over and over again this season. I wasn't even too worried about the pitching today. I mean, that was a bunch of innings, a bunch of runs given up. But even I knew short leash, just keep us in the game. Wells looked good tonight. Wells and DL Hall have both looked good through the postseason when they've pulled in. But it's too little, too late by the time they got in there.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we can get into it. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do any of this, really. But, I mean, we can talk about what went wrong, and there's plenty of blame to throw around, right? They can blame the starting pitching. I think it's very fair to blame the starting pitching. We didn't have a guy go 5 innings.
Right.
Entire playoffs.
No.
He wasn't nearly as good as he's been all season.
No, Grayson Kramer, both of them, playoff performances, and they can't get out of the second.
Right. And then, I mean, you mentioned before we could blame the offense, right? Because the offense didn't perform. We could throw some names out there.
Cedric Mullins, what's he, 2 for 50 or something now? 2 for 48?
But
maybe 45.
Okay, I don't know what specific numbers are, but I mean, just as a whole, our offense didn't get it done.
Yeah.
We can blame you can blame the roster construction, right? Oh, why is Baker on this team, and the roster construction of it all?
I mean, bad luck to lose Beans. I would have much rather seen Beans on the hill today.
Right. Yeah, you can blame bad luck with losing Bautista and losing Means. So you can just say, oh, we just got a little unfortunate. You can say, oh, we just ran into a super hot team. The Rangers are a streaky team, and they're just freaking hot, and they're hitting everything, and you just ran into a hot team. You can say that, too.
It's not even that they're streaky. They've scored the most runs in the American League this year.
Oh, yeah, good baseball team. Yeah. And then they got their pitching. It doesn't matter if their bullpen's bad when their pitching can throw – 8 innings,
right?
Their starter.
No, remember we wanted Evaldi.
That's the one guy won in the offseason, so it was fun to watch him shut down the Orioles,
right?
And kick him out of playoffs. So one guy won in the Orioles.
Yeah, exactly. And think about what that could look like if we had him.
Yeah, and you can also say that like this is just baseball, right? I mean, I saw yesterday the Diamondbacks go up 2-0 to the Dodgers, and no one was saying that the Diamondbacks are a better team than the Dodgers. But this is baseball, and stuff happens.
How about the 5 days rest? Doesn't seem to be working out so well.
I mean, the rest that they're cold. They need to play every day in baseball. Yeah,
right.
It's been you can take your pick. You can take your pick because so many things went wrong. And so yeah, we can talk about it all off season how we could have done this different. But the reality is, we just got beat, and we got beat pretty darn soundly.
Yeah.
So there's plenty of blame to go around.
No, and the Rangers, the way the Rangers played against us, if they play that way and the ALCS, they're going to the World Series. They're scoring more runs. A lot of these games are low-scoring games. They're scoring a lot more. So
yeah.
I mean, they're a very good team. They blew through the Rays and blew through us.
Yeah, and I think the Astros and Rangers will be a good series. Two good teams. It's going to be interesting to watch. Here's what I don't want to hear. Here's what I don't want to talk about. I don't want to, and I don't like to go, like, I haven't been on Twitter, and because I hate going on Twitter after losses, and I'm sure the first thing people are tweeting out is after they're mad, they're saying, what about next year? Here's what I don't want to hear. I don't want to even have this conversation right now, today. There's four things that I want to talk about. One is, I don't want to talk about this idea that we'll be there next year. Well, you know, listen, we're gonna playoffs in the next 10 years, guys. We're gonna be in there the next 10 years. So this is just year one.
We have a good core of guys, but nothing's guaranteed.
Nothing's guaranteed. Padres have a good core of guys.
Right.
The Mets have a good roster. Who knows? And any of our key players could get hurt in the offseason.
Yeah.
Mess everything up. We play in a really good division. We spent money and are going to reload, and there's no guarantee that we win the division or that we make the playoffs. Right. There's no guarantee. So don't
no guarantee, that. But we have hope. There's things to be hopeful for that we learned this season.
What I also don't want to hear, and I know we're going to talk about it, and that's fine. We do. It annoys me the fact that we just say, you know, let's just pat ourselves on the back. We had a great season. We won 100 games. We won the division. A lot of good stuff here, and maybe tomorrow I can talk about that and acknowledge that. But right now, this is a failure. The goal of the sport is to win it all. And we just went in the playoffs and got our butts kicked in the playoffs in the first round for us.
Yeah.
Of the playoffs, got our butts kicked. So I don't care that we won 100 games today. I don't care that we won the division today. I might care about that later. But right now, we just got our butts kicked.
No, those are all good things. And what about the fact that we're ahead of schedule?
Yeah, I don't hear that either.
Supposed to be there.
Yeah, that's stupid.
We're still on liftoff.
Yeah, it's stupid.
All right.
What I also don't want to hear is this playoff loss is on and put one person in there. Because I just went through like seven things.
Is Brandon – well, that's what I was going to
ask. I don't hear because Brandon Hyde, how he used his bullpen. I see Cobb Radish too early. Shut up.
I see a lot of hate on Brandon Hyde and putting all of this on Brandon Hyde. But from what I could tell, Brandon Hyde didn't walk anyone.
Yeah, and this is not a Ubaldo Jimenez, Zach Britton situation.
Like, no.
He used his best guys.
I saw that comparison with Putnam Kramer out there today. And sorry, this wasn't a Brandon Hyde, Putnam Kramer out there and ignoring all the stuff in Israel. Him and Kramer talked, and Kramer wanted to pitch.
Yeah.
So you can't say, oh, well, Kramer was distracted with all of that. No.
Well, then Dean Kramer was distracted for the past month before any of that happened because he hasn't been good for a little while. We looked at the stats. That's why we said we wanted Kyle Gibson in there.
Yes, we were requesting
as opposed to him. That's what we said. But even that, I mean, if Gibson starts this game, we still don't win it, Josh.
Right, but forget it. This game shouldn't have mattered because we had Kyle Bradish and Grayson Rodriguez, our best pitchers, pitching. And there's no question in who should have pitched game one and two. It was obvious it had to be those two. And the fact that we couldn't win one of those, let alone both of those, should have been wins in Baltimore and come here and be fine.
Yeah, I mean, Kyle Bradish went up against their, I don't know what it was, 4, 5, 6, 7 starter.
Right.
It wasn't their top guy.
No. We had to rely today on our 4th or 5th starter to try to save the season.
Right, against their top guy.
Right. Because if you put Bradish and Grayson and John Means as 1, 2, and 3, then there's a toss-up between Kramer and Gibson for 4 and 5. So it's a tough situation to be in.
And so I don't want to hear that this playoff loss is on one single person.
No.
My last thing I don't want to hear, and this, you just mentioned it, so maybe it falls under the playoff losses on. I don't want to hear all the second guessing of managerial decisions. You can second guess like a 5-4 loss in the 12th inning or something. You can second guess the heck out of managerial decisions.
Right.
You really can't second guess. You can't second guess managerial decisions on that.
Well, Matt, if Kerstead would have hit, he would have hit a grand slam every at bat.
Yeah, and if Mateo would have started today because he was so hot last game,
he
would have hit a grand slam every day.
Exactly.
Yeah. You can't do that.
No, you don't ever see anyone second guess plays that work. You don't see anyone saying on Sunday, oh, Mateo shouldn't have started. This game's on Hyde for Mateo starting. You only second guess stuff that doesn't work. It's ridiculous.
Man, the people who were calling for Flaherty to pitch in game two instead of Baker were the same people saying Flaherty shouldn't make the playoff roster. Right? It's so easy to look at something that doesn't work and second guess it. And listen, I don't think Brian Baker should have been the playoff roster. I would have taken Fuji or Cole Irvin or Josh Sroka over Brian Baker. Any of those three guys, I would have taken over Brian Baker. So I don't think he should be on the team. But again, I don't think we lost the playoffs because Brian Baker was on the roster. And if he was on the roster, I don't think Brandon Hyde should ever have used him. But again, I don't think that's why we lost this playoff series.
Okay. There's some talk in the chat room while our show's going on, complaining about how it seemed like this series Adley was not calling pitches, that Chris Holt was calling pitches from the dugout instead of letting Adley call it as they did all year.
Okay, I don't know the intricacies of the pitch calling.
And I don't know either, but I feel like if that's what was going on, like, I don't think pitch calling was the problem here. Because every big home run, you looked and the guy missed his spot.
Yeah, I mean, the only one that comes immediately to mind is, and John Smoltz is talking about this broadcast, I think it was when the bases were loaded and he threw a curveball.
But it came in.
And then he came after the curveball. Smoltz was like, you got to speed up his bat now with the fastball. And he threw a changeup following up the curveball and he smacked it for a double. That's the one that comes immediately to mind as far as like, well, why would you back up a curveball with a changeup, but yeah, I mean, I don't know the intricacies of this. I don't know. If Adley's calling all the pitches in regular season, yeah, I guess it makes sense to him call it in the playoffs. But again, I'm sure Chris Holt called pitches in the regular season in big moments, I would assume. He studied the Rangers lineup more, yeah. But yeah, if you want to be annoyed by that. I could see that, and I'm okay with you being annoyed by that. Again, plenty of blame and annoyance to pass around here. And it's frustrating because when we were hyping up the playoffs, we were like, what people are sleeping on is that Kyle Bradish was one of the best pitchers in baseball all year. That Grayson Rodriguez, when he came back from AAA, was one of the best pitchers in baseball year. And so this weakness, everyone said we had certain pitching. We're like, you guys don't know. You guys don't know. We know. But you guys don't know that this weakness is actually a strength of ours, because Kyle Bradish and Grayson Rodriguez are actually really good. And John Means is back, and he's really good too since coming back. And so it turned out what we thought, you know, here in Baltimore was kind of a secret strength. And what the national media was saying was a weakness. Well, it turns out they were right and we were wrong, because in this small series, our starting pitching stuck, just like everyone said it did. So that's unfortunate.
Yeah, I mean, it's frustrating, because it wasn't supposed to end this way. And even if we fought through this game, it would have been better. And if we lost just close games in a 5-game series, we would have came out and been like, all right, well, we need a little bit of pitching. We can get over it. We need had some bad luck. All right, we can get over this. Let's celebrate the great year. Because I want to look back at this season, and I will, once I get over this frustration of these 3 games, for the success. 101 wins, winning the AL East, that's a lot of fun. This entire season was fun. It was a fun time to wear the black and orange. It was a fun time to, with Birdland Sports this season, and see all those shirts go out, and fun to wear around Florida and people talk to me about the Orioles. So all that was fun.
No, so, I don't disagree with you. That was fun. And we won 100 games and won a division. But the reason we won 100 games and we won a division is because we're a really good baseball team. And we did not show that at all at Texas. And I wonder, like, let's throw it back and let's redo it. Let's just erase the past 4 days, whatever it was, and redo it all. And let's start from scratch. Who's winning that series? And I still think it's the Orioles. And so I just think it's frustrating because we didn't show up when we really needed to. And again, I'm sure people are going to blame, oh, youth, we have too many young players. And I guess maybe there's some truth in it. But, I mean, Dodgers have a lot of veteran players, and they struggled. Tampa Bay has had a lot of players who go through this, and they struggled. So, and the goal is to win a World Series, and you got to make the playoffs because you got yourself a chance. And it feels like, man, this is a team we looked at, the most wins in the American League. This team has a legitimate chance to go to the World Series. And I was mocking all of Fangraphs for disrespecting the Orioles, and I was taking offense to it. And well, maybe they knew something that I don't know. I mean, John Smoltz was saying something like, analytics are really good at building a 100-win team, but that doesn't do you a lot in the playoffs. And I don't know if there's some truth there, that we just built a really good regular season team that's not built for the playoffs.
But I don't even know if our team was built around analytics. I think we improved around analytics, and I think Hyde loves his left-right splits, which can kind of go with analytics. But I don't really see this as a team built around analytics. It's a team built against young rookies. It's young kids.
Yeah, and if I think about what we did well in the regular season, first of all, you know, the starting pitching's there. But offensively, we hit really well with running scoring position.
Yeah, which we didn't do this series well.
Yeah, I don't know, but I'll have to see the numbers. It seems like we didn't even get runners. Like tonight, was there just a few times we even had a runner in scoring position?
I believe we were like 4-16 runners in scoring position for the series. I believe I saw that on TV tonight.
I think we stole a bunch of bases in the regular season. I think we had just one steal. Was Gunner the only even stolen base attempt? But that was a weak attempt.
There might have been another, like, yeah, there might have been another one, but not really. We weren't aggressive.
No.
That, No, that Gunnar Henderson attempt, that miscommunication was it. And really, what's that? A hit and run on a 3-2 pitch? It's not really being super aggressive. It's kind of the right spot for a hit and run.
And listen, in their defense, it's hard to be aggressive when you're down 7 runs, right? Because you're not stealing second when you're down 6, right? Because
no, you had no opportunity.
Yeah, so you're more aggressive in closer games. So when you're leading, you're not aggressive when you're really behind. You mentioned a couple of times the lack of fight, and I hate that because in my mind I associate that with lack of effort. It's not a lack of effort issue, but I know what you're saying. Like, it's just the games weren't close.
No, this team, they still had the fight in them. You saw them all into it. They never looked like they were not trying, that they'd given up. But I meant by lack of fight, I mean like there was no back and forth. I think for half an inning, yes, on Sunday, we had the lead. And I think that was it for the entire series.
Right.
There was no back and forth. And what we're used to with this team is the comeback kids. We're used to, we fall behind, we come back.
Yeah, but we fall 1 or 2 runs behind.
Exactly.
10 runs behind.
And we saw that on Sunday. We were getting a 3-run home run in the 9th. And that's great, except we were down by 6 by that point.
Yeah. That's really great if you don't have the grand slam in the 3rd.
Right, exactly. You don't have that grand slam.
It's a game-winning home run.
And it's a game-winning home run, and it's typical Orioles magic. Yeah. There was no magic in this offseason.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it was a bad playoffs. It was just a bad, bad showing. And props to the Rangers. They played extremely well. If you look at that lineup, you're like, man, that lineup could score some runs. Evaldi can pitch. Evaldi could always pitch. I had no doubt he was going to pitch well tonight. But, man, that lineup can really put up runs and really can hit. Corey Seager is an absolute monster. So props to the Rangers. But, yeah, what a just disappointing showing for the Orioles. I don't know what to say about it. It is.
It's sad. It's depressing. It's frustrating because we expected so much more.
We're talking the coming weeks, and we can get there about the youth on this team, and this is a necessary step in this team's growth, and Jackson Holliday is coming, and Kobe Mayo is coming, and other guys are coming,
but you're also right. It's time to shut down the extreme, the hot takes. We got to fire Brandon Hyde. No, he's still manager of the year. He'll get manager of the year. Like, this doesn't mean fire Brandon Hyde. This doesn't mean move on from Cedric Mullins because he struggled at the plate. This doesn't mean these extremes. This doesn't mean Grayson Rodriguez is not part of this rotation next year.
Yeah, I mean, the question of the off seasons, when the off season comes, it's going to be like, how far away from it? Like, you just watched the 3 games. If you asked me prior to, and we talked about this, prior to this playoff series, I was like, you know, this team really needs nothing. It's just bring them back next year. Give Gunnar an extension, give Adley an extension in the offseason, then bring everybody back and let's run it back because we have all the pieces in place and we'll be getting some more young talent.
Yep.
But now after watching this playoff series, just one series, Josh, accuse me of hot takes, but after one series, I'm like, well, maybe we need another big bat in the middle lineup. Maybe we need another starter. Maybe we need another bullpen. So all of a sudden, prior 3 games ago, I said this team is set for next year, as is. Now, after 3 games, here's my hot take. I think they need another hitter, another starter, and another bullpen arm, minimum.
Hitter, starter, bullpen arm.
And maybe that's me overreacting because I just witnessed it. But that's how I'm feeling after watching those 3
games. I think it's funny you're saying a hitter, a batter, a bullpen arm. That's because what you're trying to say is that at every level we failed in these playoffs. Starting pitcher failed, bullpen failed, and bats failed.
Yep, all of them.
Defense was okay. Our defense behind the – I don't remember any major errors. I think Mateo flubbed the ball.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Yeah,
I think
Mateo did flub a ball on Sunday. Yeah. I don't really remember other ones.
Yeah. I remember some good outfield play from Austin Hayes and Cedric Mullins. I really think the 5 days off messed with this team. I think that's part of it. I also think this team, they struggled at the end of the season and almost gave Tampa the division and struggled. And I think the only thing that worked for us is that Tampa struggled even more. So yeah. I think it's a long season. I think the fact that we won 101 games is pretty amazing. I think going into next season, getting Tyler Wells back in your rotation is a big thing. I think seeing Grayson Rodriguez, Tyler Wells take those next steps will be huge for the rotation. I'm interested to see what they do with DL Hall. Is he a permanent bullpen arm, or is it the plan to get him back into this rotation? Gibson's here again next year, right? Isn't that a 2-year deal?
I thought it was a 1-year deal, but
maybe it was a one. But you're right. A veteran arm would be helpful. There was no. We talked at the end of the season about a stopper and needing a stopper, and is Grayson Rodriguez our stopper, or Kyle Bradish our stopper? Well, none of them showed up when we needed them here. So there's definitely some pitching things to work with. And I hate being critical because we won 101 games and we won the AL East. And we've done something that we haven't done in 10, 12 years, whatever it's been. But it sure was frustrating week of Orioles baseball.
Yeah, I mean, how much do you overreact over 3 games? And I don't know. I don't know how much you overreact over 3 games. Is this an indication of us as the way we're constructed that's not good enough for the playoffs? Or do you put more stock in the fact that we were better than the Rangers in the regular season? We were better than everybody else in the American League in the regular season, right? Do you put more stock in that? And then you look at the end of the season. You mentioned struggling at the end. Part of that related to injuries, right? Like it hurt. Like Felix Bautista kind of took the wind out of our sails a little bit. And we're a little hopeful. Hopefully he might come back. And it turns out he couldn't come back. And now he's actually yesterday had, I guess, successful Tommy John surgery. So his road to recovery has started. And then you had other like kind of you traded for Flaherty and that kind of imploded on you. Like you thought, I think when Elias traded for Flaherty, he was hoping Flaherty would be one of these guys starting a playoff game. I think that was the hope, that Flaherty could be that third or fourth starter for you. That didn't work out at all. We also had to trade for Fujinami, which obviously was an up and down thing, but he wasn't good enough to make the roster. So you're like, oh, that didn't work out in the second half of the season either. So there were like some legitimate things that kind of got in the way the second half of the year. That some cracks in the armor, if you will, the second half of the year.
Yeah. And Billy Joel. Of course we gotta blame Billy Joel.
Oh man, the traffic mess. I've never seen anything like it. You've never seen anything like it.
If it was a night game, we would have won. 1 o'clock game, we don't play well on day games.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a real stat. I'm just trying to come up with more excuses for this team. You know what I feel like? I feel like the people who try to give excuses for why they don't go to Oriole games. And they're like, oh, violence, murders, the weather.
Traffic. That's what people in Tampa Bay said.
Yeah.
While we're flying across multiple states, my man Scotty Spliffin in the comments, flying from Sacramento to go to games. He's not complaining about traffic. He's talking about traffic. So, yeah, and listen, Oriole fans showed up, by the way. Great crowd.
Let's talk about a little bit of positives. The home games were fun for the crowd. The crowd was into it, especially that first game being delayed with the rain. By the time they got to the introductions, like people were in their seats. It was packed, and it was just – everyone was hyped up.
It was loud.
It was the O for Joan Jett was loud. The cheering for each introduction. They were cheering on the players as they ran out for warm-ups and stretches. So it was loud. It was fun.
Yeah, it was fun. Yeah, almost all the fans were into it. How many people were there? 46,000. And I think 45,999 were into it, standing on every pitch. Except the lady in front of me was not into it. She was the one out of the 46,000 who didn't want to stand.
Right.
She was a little irritated. Other people were standing around her. But everybody else, super into the game, pumped about it. So, yeah, it was a great crowd.
Yeah, she wanted the usher to tell people to sit down.
Yeah, listen, I don't blame her. she was not expecting, doesn't know about playoff baseball.
No, and that's,
it's one of the reasons I didn't take my son, is because he's small and people be standing all the time, and I knew he wouldn't be able to see him, be get upset. Like, people don't know how playoff baseball works. So
I had,
don't play it very often, and no one knows.
I had that thought multiple times attending both game one and game two, watching other people, that you don't know how playoff baseball works.
Yeah.
You've never been around this.
Playoff baseball, yeah.
Yeah. You don't,
I mean, that's fine, because we haven't been there very often, so it's not their fault.
No. So maybe this was a introduction to playoff baseball for the Oriole fan as well.
Yeah, if you don't want to stand during a game, maybe just watch from home.
This season was fun. The getting into the playoffs was fun. I don't like the 5 days off. I think there's been, they've only done it for 2 years now, and I think MLB teams are going to push back against it and say, hey, we won the division, and then we come in rested and not on fire, where the wild card team comes in like bats blazing, all warmed up, ready to go. So I think maybe they go back to a one game wild card in the future or something in order to try to avoid those 5 days off.
That's not zero chance.
I know. The problem is TV revenue.
Money.
It's all money.
You never do. No sport has ever done money. Less of anything.
You're right. It's all about money.
Always more games.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's. I think it is a disadvantage for the hitters. It is an advantage for the pitchers, because
it's definitely an advantage for the
pitchers. We can line up a rotation. Texas was not able to line up the rotation.
Maybe they reseed or something to try to balance out the division winners.
It was interesting. Texas chose to start two lefties in Camden Yards.
Yeah.
Not even their best pitchers. Well, Montgomery's good, but the other guy, I think my opinion is it had almost all to do with the fact that they're left-handed and throw with their left hand.
Right.
Because
of the wall. Yards.
Yeah, because of the wall. So if you throw a lefty, Hyde's going to throw out his righty lineup, which means when they hit home runs, they're trying to hit it over that great big wall. And so you know what? In the regular season, it doesn't really impact it. You don't line up pitchers like that. Right. But in the play, I'm curious. I don't know. What is our record at home against left-handed starting pitchers? Is that a stat that's easily looked up and accessible?
I think it is. All right,
well, someone, some nerd out there, some coconut out there, tell me, what was our record at home against left-handed starters? Because I think that might be a little bit of a weak spot for us. And by the way, we only have the one left-handed starter. I mean, before John Means, was it just Cole Irvin was our only left-handed starter when he started? So we very right-handed heavy starting rotation for us, which means other teams could line up their lefties to hit it over, to hit it onto Utah Street. So,
all right, I've got some splits.
Okay, there's no way, Josh, you are not adept enough to know how Baseball Reference works to figure out that stat
this
quickly. I have zero faith that whatever you're going to say is going to be relevant to what I was saying, but go ahead and share your stats anyway.
All right, let's see. Versus...
Here we go.
All right, this is...
At home versus left-handed starters.
All right, let's see. At home,
I just wanted you to account for these two factors.
Yeah, funny thing is, all right, let's see. I've got the stats versus left. I've got the stats at home. I'm trying to find the stats of the two combined.
But you need to combine them,
huh?
Yeah.
No, but I've got the stats. I found this interesting: left versus right. Okay.
Yeah, fine.
Versus lefts, we have 53 home runs this season. During right versus right-handed pitchers, 133 home runs.
I don't know if that's interesting or not, Josh. It probably
is. Because you want to know if it's at home because of the wall.
Yeah, or like how many innings pitched, right? Because it's presumably they're more righties in baseball than lefties. So telling me that they hit more against right, well, maybe they just
maybe they played
a lot
more
righties.
Okay,
that's not. I mean, it's probably true that they hit less home runs per average off lefties than righties, but that's just, that doesn't tell me that.
All right. Well, I will
No, you don't even look it up, Judge.
No,
I'll tell Orioles, to look it up for me because you can't find that.
The Baltimore Orioles hit .236 against left-handed pitchers at home this season. They had 62 games at home where they faced a left-handed pitcher, whether it was a starter or a reliever.
Okay.
At home, they have 19 home runs versus a lefty. And 757 at bats versus a lefty. Well, 859 plate appearances.
And 19 home runs?
And 19 home runs.
That's abysmal.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to know what it is versus righties at home?
It's a lot more than 19.
Let's see. We batted .255 at home against righties.
That's 20 points higher.
We had 2,000 plate appearances, 2,052 plate appearances, and we hit 67 home runs.
Yeah. I'll do the math here. So it sounds like we had four times the bats against righties. Now this math is getting really complicated. Wait,
maybe the wall hurts us more than it helps us.
Yeah. I'm just saying, so we have constructed our lineups clearly to be left-handed heavy, right?
Yeah.
Gunner, lefty. Kerstadt, lefty. O'Hearn, lefty. Like, we got a lot of lefties right. We can throw at them. We're all ready for our lefties.
Yeah.
But what do we do when they throw a left-handed pitcher? All of a sudden, we're in trouble. All of a sudden, Urias is playing. We got Urias out there. We got Mateo out there.
Right.
Yeah. We might need to do something about that.
Yeah.
And on the reverse side, like I said, we only have John Means, our only left-handed starter. And Cole Irvin, I don't know if he counts, but we lack left-handed starting pitching. So maybe something to look into.
Yeah. But are you impressed I was able to pull those stats?
Yeah, I don't know how reliable those stats are.
Ask me for something else.
No, I'm not doing
this. I got all the splits here. Whatever you want.
Okay. You do some like maybe show prep for next week and you pull out some interesting nuggets to share from all your research.
I don't know. It's this website StatMuse.
Okay.
And you just type it in and it brings you type in, I typed Orioles batting average against righties this season at home and it brought up all the stats.
Oh, that's pretty easy.
Yeah, exactly. It was way easier than I expected to pull it up.
Yeah.
It's probably some like ChatGPT type thing or something. I don't know.
Also, can I say I've gotten a couple of text messages and like Facebook Messenger too with people?
Yeah.
About the Orioles loss. Listen, I'm not responding to any text messages. Don't text me when they lose.
Oh.
I probably won't even respond when they win, to be honest. But when they lose, don't text me about it. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to do this podcast right now. I certainly don't want to go on my phone and text people saying, I don't even know what to say. Okay. When you text me about them losing, I don't know how to respond to that. And I'm annoyed that you said it, and I'm not responding ever.
All right, so I got to share. I'll share. You want to see a text about the Orioles losing that pisses me off?
Okay.
I had softball tonight. Game at 7:00. Game at 9:00. So I went ahead and said, "Hey guys, I'll play it to 7:00, but then I got to go watch this game.
Playoff baseball.
I can't stay for the 9:00. So I went and played the 7:00. I watched the first inning driving home, and I get this text just as we're starting the podcast. All right, here's the deal. Some of y'all got kids, cool. We all love baseball, agreed. But if you're going to leave early to go watch a ball game when you can watch it on your phone, it's stupid, Josh.
Was that sent to the whole group?
Sent to the whole group.
Love that.
And then a screenshot of the Orioles box score.
Ooh.
And then if you can't hold on to your commitments, then let us know so we don't have to keep wondering who's going to show up. We shouldn't have to beg people to play. If you don't like being called out, then you should have thought about your decision. If you don't like what I had to say, cry me a river. You're a grown man.
Oh, my gosh. I love it when a whiny baby calls someone else a baby and say, grow up.
I responded. Ooh, I said, not even sure whose number this is, but whoever's calling me out for not playing at 9 because of the Oriole game clearly doesn't know me. Maybe I'll just focus on Little League. And I got peace fingers back. So I might have just quit my softball team over some stupid guy. Yeah, and I don't even know whose number. I don't even know who it is on the softball team because I don't I play with a bunch of guys I don't know that well, and I don't have his phone number in there.
Yeah, he's probably 22 years old, a fan of the Florida Gators or something. He doesn't understand sports commitments and fandom.
And clearly doesn't understand that not only did I have to watch the game, we got to talk about it after this, and there's no way I can focus on that game. What he should have texted me is, hey, Josh, congratulations on that home run, probably the longest ball you ever hit in your life during that 7 o'clock game. That's what he should have hit, sent. Because I had a great hit in the first game.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But I want to let that make you quit because he's just one jerk.
And I know.
He's a random jerk.
I know.
And on every team there is random jerks. And I'm sure the other guys are more understanding that random jerk.
It's just an example of like just a stupid text to get.
Yeah, I would have taken that off the group, and I would have sent a nice little private chat to him, asking for his name and address, maybe. What a little dweeb that dude is.
Right.
But yeah, that's annoying. So yeah, that's annoying. More annoying than, like, I just got like the tough loss text.
I understand that. Losses,
and that tough loss irritated me. I can't imagine that.
No, I believe the only text we sent during the game today was I sent unbelievable, and then you or dad responded with sad.
I mean, the guy, like, the fact that this guy thinks his softball, stupid fall softball game on some random night is more important than a playoff game for a team you've been following your entire life who hasn't won a playoff game in so many years. It's so insane to me that I think this guy should be not playing sports. Like, I think whoever texted that should not be playing sports. Honestly, it's such a horrendous text message to send. And just the more I think about it, the more insane I think that is to send someone, especially because you're playing another sport. People should appreciate like sports when you're playing a sport. Like their fanaticism, and understand the difference between a rec league softball team and actual real professional sports.
And a playoff game that, like, sorry, it's a lot of people. I know a lot of people don't understand it, but the Orioles is like family to us.
He's one of those guys that get mad when a player takes off someday in June because their wife's having a baby.
Right.
And he gets mad at that, the guy for taking off. Get your priorities straight, dude.
Right.
You got a game here.
He's probably mad because I missed last week because I had to coach a little league game. Yeah. But guess what? I'm a 43-year-old man playing softball. Everything else in my life's a priority before softball.
Yeah.
Just how it goes.
Yeah, I think that's a normal position to take.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know.
I'm annoyed you shared that mess with me.
I know. I see Scotty in the chat is also texting that he's angry about this text. I'll take you. Let me share a good story then.
Let's end with this.
All right. Let's talk Little League.
All right.
Because I told you we had a tough loss while you and I were up in Maryland.
The Little League Orioles.
And you and I had a great time up in Maryland going to the games. It was well worth it. It was great to
hang out with Dad.
A lot of fun with playoff good baseball.
Seats. 388, row one. Surprisingly good seats. Yeah.
I am shocked how much fun 388 is.
Well, row one. I don't know.
Row one. Yeah. It'd be even more amazing if people understood it's playoff baseball and you don't get up out of your seat every 2 seconds.
Oh, that bothers me zero. I was actually annoyed. Because all you got to do, you get this extra room in row one. You just got to move your knees to a little angle, very little effort, and they can get by. I don't understand what the deal is.
It was twice an inning.
You just move the knee and back and move twice the an knee. Inning.
It's irritating.
And back.
It's irritating. It's almost as irritating as having a whole row to myself on an unfilled airplane, and then a couple decides they want to sit next to me. So then I have the only middle seat with an occupant. On my plane ride home, but
there was the aisle seat was open next to me. I was able to scoot over, but that's a very stressful situation because I was like middle of the flight, got in there, and then you just watch everybody come in. Please, no one sit in the seat next to me. Please, no one. Like every person is stressing me out. No, they're going to do it, and then they didn't, and I was able to move over to the aisle, had a space in between.
Oh, good. Yeah. All right, Little League. So come back. I come back Monday. I got a Little League game Monday night. So I take a little nap before the Little League game. I'm not sure if you got a nap in Monday as well.
I had a job.
It was a long day Monday. So I got a little nap in before Little League. So because I started working at the airport and worked all through that. But anyway, I get up, make my lineup. I head on over to the game, and I decide, all right, we're playing this team that beat us pretty good, like slaughter roll us in the first game of the season. So I decide to put in some guys that don't pitch that often and let them kind of get their workout in, not going to win. And we get into this where I get to where we're down. We're down by four runs. You can only score five an inning.
Right.
But we're down four. It's the very last inning. And I'm like, all right, well, letting this guy kid pitch. He gets two outs. And then a guy gets on, and then he steals second, then he steals third, because that's what happens in this little league. Like, yeah. If he gets past the catcher. So I make the call. I go out there. I'm on the sideline pacing, and I it sucks to pull a 10-year-old out.
You have very few chances to actually win a game. So
I haven't pulled a 10-year-old out in any games.
Okay, because you're all about having fun.
Yeah. Oh, it's and we're down by five at this point. Sorry, the guy scored. Another guy got the third. We're down by five. So I go out and I give him the hook. Never done it before. And I call this other kid in and I say, just get me one strikeout. Just get this guy out. I said, you see that guy on third? If he scores, the game's over. We lose. We don't even have a chance to come back. I then go up to my catcher and I say, you see that guy on third? If he scores, the game is over. We have no chance. Yeah. Like, we just go home.
Whatever it takes.
You're going to get him out.
Yeah.
So I pull the pitcher in. He strikes out the next guy.
Nice.
Gets us all off the field. We come up. I have a little huddle with my team. I tell them, guys, we're down by five. It's the last inning. It's bottom of the ninth. Like, this is our only chance. Be patient up there at the plate. Let's see what happens. And we get on. We get some walks. We score two runs. He ends up walking two guys in. Now we have the bases loaded with Owen up. Nice. And Owen hits a shot to right field, clears the bases.
Awesome.
We hit the five-run limit, and we walk off tie. We tied the game. It ended right there. But I was excited that it was my first time actually making managerial decisions and not just, like, coaching kids.
Yeah, and
making the call.
We're the tie.
And it got us the tie. So it was exciting. An exciting ending. And kind of exciting managerial moment, something that I did this week and that Brandon Hyde was not able to do all weekend.
So, Michael Elias, if you're listening, maybe, and if you're going to fire Brandon Hyde, like the fans are clamoring for, I think you might have just found your replacement.
I will say it's hard to pull 10-year-olds. I did give this kid the hook, but I wanted to do it the inning before to a kid, and I wanted to do it the inning before to another kid. And if I would have done that, maybe we would have won instead of tied, but I was just glad I at least did it. Because it's 10-year-olds. You want to keep giving them chances.
If you can't pull a 10-year-old, you got no chance at pulling Max Scherzer out of a game.
Exactly. Yeah. Max Scherzer's going to pitch in the LCS, isn't he?
Yeah, he is. I mean, I think Texas is only going to be better. That's going to be interesting.
I think so, too. My money would be on Texas right now for World Series. Yeah. I think they're really hot.
Yeah, they're going to be tough to beat. Though Houston is kind of built for the playoffs, and they're going to be tough to beat, too. I think it's going to be...
Yeah.
Yep. Interesting playoffs. But and for us, we can enjoy it stress-free now. Just enjoy some good old baseball without it stressing about it.
Yeah. Well, we can look at Ravens football because that's not disappointing.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's going to go one of the worst. And you throw Maryland Terrapin football in Ohio State. It was just one of the worst, just most disastrous weekend in Baltimore sports history. This has to be up there. As far as just for a weekend, this past weekend, one of the worst ever sports weekends for Baltimore.
It was. It was pretty bad.
Yeah. All right, let's get out of here.
No, it was tough. Yeah. Maybe next
week. Anything else for the good of the group?
Huh?
Anything else for the good of the group?
I was just going to say, just now that it's off season, maybe next week we'll look at our bold predictions. We'll get some more guests on the show and try to look forward. And try to have some good perspective looking back and then get excited for next year. Because after all, pretty much all of Section 336, we've asked for meaningful games in September. And we made it to October this year. So
yeah, October 10th. Good run.
Yeah, not a bad run.
Yeah,
I hope we can make it to November soon. But October's better than July.
Yeah, and now we can, you know, pay attention to see if an actual lease is signed.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah, so.
Oh, we haven't even gotten into that.
Yeah.
Oh.
I mean, it's going to be, I mean, you. Hey. I know Berlin's excited. For me, it's like, I'm interested in what's going to happen with the ownership with Angelos and with, are we going to sign a lease? Are we going to sign any players? Are we going to extend any players? I mean, is this a one-hit wonder, or are we building something special here? I think this offseason will tell us some stuff.
Let me see if Connolly's available. Let's get him to talk about John Angelos.
Oh, yeah. He'll drop some facts.
Let's see if he can open the books for us.
Yeah, yeah. He won't hold back with his opinions on him.
Yep.
But, yeah, all right. Yeah, we'll be here. We'll come back. We'll be here next week. We'll be here every week in the offseason.
We never go anywhere.
In the offseason. So we'll do a little bit of Ravens talk in there too, depending on how that goes.
But either way, there is hope for the Orioles and there's excitement for the future. And you're going to find all that in Section 336 throughout the offseason. You just got to let us deal with it. I said on Twitter today, I said, we're doing the podcast after this game, good or bad. Our emotions are going to be filled with this episode.
Yeah, I know. I saw that tweet and one of the reasons why I felt like I couldn't cancel this after watching that business performance.
I know.
It was already tweeted out, so I had to come up
with it. Trust me, I told Kelly I don't feel like doing the podcast.
Yeah. And I think if you're listening to this, I think you're sick because you just saw the Orioles lose and now you want to come here and hear more about it. I think you're sicko if you listen to this episode.
Yeah, but I feel like we needed to do it tonight because I need to get all these bad feelings out so that I can focus on good feelings next week.
All right,
we'll
see.
All right,
we'll see next week. All right. All right, in the meantime, you know, do all the things we tell you to do. Twitter, iTunes, reviews, Apple Podcasts.
Yep, do all that. Commiserate with us.
Yep, you can follow us on Twitter. My handle is at Section336. You follow Josh.
At Josh Soroka.
Thanks for listening, boys and girls. As always... Go O's.